A Narrative of the Life of Mrs. Mary Jemison, read by Joanne Shenandoah, Oneida. The story you are about to hear goes back more than 250 years. It's the story of Mary Jemison, whose family immigrated to Pennsylvania from Ireland in the year of her birth, 1743. In 1755, near the onset of the French and Indian War, when Mary was just 12, she was captured by Shawnee Indians and then adopted by Seneca Indians, who gave her the name Dickie Wamis. But to most who knew her, she was simply called the White Woman. She lived until the age of 90 and spent nearly 80 years among the Seneca. In 1823, when Mary Jemison was 80 years old, she told her story to a minister and historian named James E. Seaver. She was illiterate, so Seaver took down her story and published it under the title A Narrative of the Life of Mrs. Mary Jemison. Jemison's narrative begins before the French and Indian Wars and continues through and after the American Revolutionary War. During this time, she married two Indian men and had 8 children by them. She became a landowner and attained a fair amount of wealth. Her life is filled with highs and lows, perhaps the lowest of which is the death of her 3 sons, 2 of them murdered by their own brother. Her story is also filled with the horrors of war, con artists who try to wrest her wealth from her, and her difficulty with being torn between loving her native family and missing her birth family. Several times she has the chance to leave her native family, but chooses to stay. The many ironies of her life also include hiring herself out to a black family in order to feed her native children. Through the years, historians have questioned Seaver's account of Mary Jemison's narration. Many salacious and untrue stories were passed off as Indian capture stories in the 19th century. But by now, this story is believed to be largely true. As you'll hear, the language is archaic. After all, Jemison is essentially an 18th century woman. Also, one has to wonder if some of the language came from Jemison herself or if Seaver contributed some of the vocabulary, which seems expansive for someone who mostly stopped speaking English at age 12. We've made only a few changes here. The word squaw, which is used liberally in the book, has been changed to woman. Even in the 18th century, squaw was a derogatory term and not likely used by Jemison herself. There are also many author's notes throughout the book. These are meant to clarify places and historical events, but they aren't part of the narrative, so we've left them and a few other redundant stories out. In a fairly long introduction to the book, James Seaver describes Mary Jemison, who, although 80 years old, is still quite alert and strong. Here's a brief portion of James Seaver's description of Mary Jemison. In stature, she is very short and considerably under the middle size and stands tolerably erect with her head bent forward, apparently from her having for a long time been accustomed to carrying heavy burdens in a strap placed across her forehead. Her complexion is very white for a woman of her age, and although the wrinkles of 40 years are deeply indented in her cheeks, yet the crimson of youth is distinctly visible. Her eyes are light blue, a little faded by age, and naturally brilliant and sparkling. Her sight is quite dim, though she is able to perform her necessary labor without the assistance of glasses. Her cheekbones are high and rather prominent, and her front teeth and the lower jaw are sound and good. When she looks up and is engaged in conversation, her countenance is very expressive. But from her long residence with the Indians, she has acquired the habit of peeping from under eyebrows, as they do with the head inclined downwards. Formerly, her hair was of a light chestnut brown. It is now quite gray, a little curled, of middling length, and tied in a bunch behind. She informed me that she had never worn a cap nor a comb. She speaks English plainly and distinctly, with a little of the Irish emphasis, and has the use of words so well as to render herself intelligible on any subject with which she is acquainted. Her recollection and memory exceeded my expectation. It cannot be reasonably supposed that a person of her age has kept the events of 70 years in so complete a chain as to be able to assign to each its proper time and place. She, however, made her recital with as few obvious mistakes as might be found in that of a person of 50. She walks with a quick step without a staff, and I was informed by Mr. Clute that she could yet cross a stream on a log or pole as steadily as any other person. Her passions are easily excited. At a number of periods in her narration, tears trickled down her grief-worn cheek, and at the same time, a rising sigh would stop her utterance. And now, a narrative of the life of Mrs. Mary Jemison, read by Joanne Shenandoah, Oneida.